Dancing on the beat.
But I didn't let, you know, getting cut or, you know, teams telling me I wasn't good enough. Well, I didn't let it discourage me. I went over to Europe. I was in Italy, won a championship over there, and I continued to work on my game, just like I did in college, just like I did in high school. I went back to the gym at night, every night, you know, working on my jump shot, working on my ball handling, working on different things to try to get better because I knew I deserved to be in the NBA. Next thing you know, that's when the Milwaukee Bucks called me. Said we want to bring you into camp. So I went to camp and I played the first day. And after that, they said, you know what, we don't need to see you play no more. We know enough about you. They watched it like we followed your whole career from Michigan State to being in Italy, being in Spain. It was like one thing we like about you is that you always continue to get better. Because that's all I knew was hard work.
You can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile. You could be the hero, you could get the gold. Breaking all the records they thought never could be broke.
Hello, hello. I gotta come up after all guys got done dancing and I was down there trying to get my move on, man, but man, that video, man, brought back some great memories, man. You know, I wish I could still do some of that stuff. You see, I done put a little weight on now. You know, when you get done playing, man, it ain't the same. It's like, once you have to be at the gym all the time, and once when you finish and you retire, you don't have to go to the gym. I don't go to the gym anymore. I drive to the gym, I look at it, I say, man, I should go in there. Nah, not today, I'm gonna go home. Go play some golf or something, but I did play some pickup last week. You know, I kind of felt some flashbacks, like, man, I need to make a comeback. And then my back was hurting the next day. I said, nah, I'm cool. I'll leave it alone. I'm gonna keep playing golf. But I'm very honored to be here today. Like you said, I'm from Flint, Michigan. Anybody follow, like, the news right now? You know, we got the Flint water crisis going on right now. You know, there's a lot of, you know, not very many good things going on in Flint. So in Flint, coming up in high school and when I was growing up, my parents used to always instill hard work in me. You know, that's what I always talk about, man, hard work, because, you know, my parents didn't give me anything. You know, anything I wanted when I was growing up, I had to work for it. You know, as far as, you know, cleaning windows, cleaning the house, vacuuming, mopping, doing whatever I had to do. And then next thing you know, I started detailing cars, and I was washing my mom's car every day. And then next thing you know, I got my own car, so I was washing that. I got a little the hand-me-down, so I kept good care of my mom's car because I knew she was gonna hand that down to me. So I had to keep it clean, keep it looking right, so it was ready for me. So once I got it, you know, I used to keep my car clean. And next thing you know, like, all my neighbors, everybody who lived across the street, they'd see me washing my car all the time, so they would pay me to wash their car. So I would detail, wash it. You know, I had a little business. I had like 2-3 cars every day, you know, lined up in the driveway, making some money, you know, just for some gas or to go out to eat or whatever I wanted to do. But, you know, nothing was given to me. I worked for it, you know, and I think that's something that it stuck with me throughout my whole career, because, You know, I was Flint's all-time leading scorer. I'm still Flint's all-time leading scorer. You know, nobody scored more points than me in the city of Flint. So I'm like, oh, thank you. So, you know, I was a big-time scorer. From there, I got recruited to a lot of schools. I took 5 visits at the time. I think still you can take 5 visits to 5 different colleges. I went to UConn. I went to Minnesota. I went to University. I went to Penn State. I went to University of Michigan, and then I went to Michigan State. So I visited all 5 of those schools to try to decide where I wanted to go to school next. And one thing about Michigan State and Coach Izzo, I don't know if you guys follow college basketball now, but Coach Izzo is probably one of the best coaches, you know, in the game. But when I first started, it was only like his 2nd, 3rd year. The year before, you know, I went to Michigan State. It was in they was in the NIT. They didn't even make the NCAA tournament. But the next year I got there, and I chose Michigan State. You know, I felt like it was the best, you know, school for me. So I went to Michigan State. You know, and I like Coach Izzo because when he recruited me, he didn't tell me a lot of lies. When you're getting recruited, a lot of coaches come in, they tell you what they want, what you want to hear. You know, you ask them a question, they're going to tell you yes, whatever it is. Hey, can I get the newest Jordans? Yeah, we got you. We're going to get you everything. But when Coach Izzo came in, it was like, he said, look, Charlie, I'm not going to promise you nothing. I want you to come in, you got to work for it. And I was like, you know what? This is the kind of coach I need to play for, because I don't want nothing given to me. I want to work for it. So I got there, and there was a guy that was playing in front of me. He got hurt, and next thing you know, I was starting as a freshman. I started every game my freshman year. We went on to win the Big Ten championship, won our conference championship, went to the NCAA tournament. We made it to the Sweet 16, and it was a great year. You know, it was a long year, you know, especially going from high school to college. It was very tough. So for me, after the season, I was like, man, I'm tired. I need to rest. This has been a long season. You know, coaches practice as hard, you know, 2-hour practices all season. I need to take some time off. So I was taking some time off, and it might have been like 2 or 3 days after the season. And Coach Izzo, he was out recruiting, you know, for the next year, and he called me on the phone. He said, well, Charlie, you know, I heard you not, you know, in the gym. I'm like, well, Coach, season just ended. Like, I need to rest. He said, nah, you got to get ready for next year. You need to be back in the gym tomorrow, today. I need you working out because we made it to the Sweet 16, but we want to get better than that. And I was just like, you know, he didn't say it like that. I mean, he said some curse words. You know, I'm making it sound nice, but he cussed me out pretty bad. Like, it was, it was rated R. It was rated PG crowd, so I'm going to keep it simple. But, like, he cut into me pretty bad. And after that, I was back in the gym working out. But one thing I learned about that is that you can't rest on what you did the year before. You know, you always got to get better because other teams are getting better. And that was one thing that me and my teammates at all of us, every year, every season that we went into, we knew that didn't nobody work as hard as us. In NCAA history, to win every game by 10 or more points in the NCAA tournament. So we won that national championship. It was probably, you know, the greatest feeling in the world for me at the time is, you know, to win a national championship, something that you worked very hard for to finally accomplish that goal. You know, it was great. You know, we celebrated. We went back to Michigan State. I would go, you know, when you get to college, you know, you have classrooms that look like this. I would walk into class. I'd probably be a little late, like 2-3 minutes. Everybody in the class would stand up and start clapping for me. I'm like, oh, all right, yeah, okay. You know, because we just won a championship, so everybody was just happy as can be. And, you know, it was definitely got the red carpet treatment after that. And then my senior year, you know, everybody thought we wasn't going to make it back to the Final Four because some of our top players went to the NBA. But we ended up making it back to the Final Four. I think we ended up losing to Arizona that year. They had a really good team, but the thing is, we made it back. I mean, so in my career, I went to 3 Final Fours, 1 NCAA championship, and also 4 conference championships. Right now, I'm still the all-time winningest player in Michigan State history. Nobody's won more games than I have, and I graduated in 2001, so There's been 15 teams or 15 classes that haven't won as many games as I've won, which is something that I'm very proud of, because when during my whole career, high school and college, pro, I just wanted to win. You know, it's whatever I need to do to help the team win. Oh, thank you. Because like I told you, I was Flint's all-time leading scorer, and then I go to college and everybody can score. So it was like, okay, what can I do? So I became the team's best defender. You know, I had to go out there and guard the other team's best offensive player. So 4 years in a row, at the end of the season, we have awards, and I won the award for best defensive player. So I was very proud of that, you know. So I just feel like, you know, I just wanted to win. Like, hey, what I got to do to help the team win? So after my college career, you know, I thought, you know, I had a couple of teammates the season before. You know, they got drafted in the first round. So quite naturally, I'm thinking, okay, you know, I'm on the same team. I'm one of the best players. I'm going to get drafted too. I got to get drafted. So next thing you know, I had family and friends over to watch the draft. And, you know, my name didn't get called that night. You know, so it was a very humbling experience. But at the same time, it's like, okay. You know, even though I knew I could play at that level, I didn't get drafted. There was guys that got drafted that I felt I was better than, that I played better than, but for some reason or another, you know, teams drafted somebody else. So, but I got a call from the Phoenix Suns, and they was like, well, look, Charlie, we know we didn't draft you, but we're very high on you, we like you, we want you to come to our summer league. I said, all right, cool. So I went to summer league in Phoenix, and ended up, like, leading summer league in scoring. I was averaging like 25 points a game. So Phoenix are like, you know what, we're going to sign you. So they ended up signing me to a contract. You know, so I moved to Phoenix. Everything was going great. And I got hurt. I sprained my ankle really bad. And I couldn't play for a while. And then once I could play, you know, by that time it was kind of like, okay, you know, I wasn't playing as well as I thought I could play. And next thing you know, they cut me, you know, which was probably the hardest thing in the world, you know, to go to practice one day, you walk in, coach say, Charlie, I need to talk to you for a second. I'm like, all right, you know, so I don't even know what it was. So we go, and he said, well, look, Charlie, we got to let you go. You know, we got, you know, you're not getting the job done for us. I'm like, oh, okay. So, you know, so I pack my stuff up, and I got to go home, and, you know, I'll tell my wife, hey, look, you know, we're not gonna be in Phoenix anymore. So, you know, so that was very, very tough. You know, the hardest thing, you know, to go home and say, hey, got cut, you know, gotta find something else to do. So I ended up playing in a minor league in Phoenix. It was the ABA. I don't think the ABA is still going on, but it was called the ABA. I was playing well in the ABA, and the Dallas Mavericks called. They said, you know what, we want to sign you. I said, cool. So I go to Dallas. I moved from Michigan to Phoenix. I moved from Phoenix to Dallas. It's like, okay, finally, here we go. So I get there, and they say, well, Charlie, we just want you to be a practice player for us. I said, all right. So next thing you know, we're practicing, and next thing you know, the trade deadline comes around. And if you're familiar with basketball, you know, once the trade deadline, the team was kind of just telling us, like, you know, hey, nobody's going to get traded. Everybody's fine. But next thing you know, they made a trade. And NBA teams can only have 15 players on it. And I was that 15th guy, you know, because I was, you know, a rookie, you know, undrafted. So I was that 15th guy. So when they made the trade, they sent three guys to Denver, and Denver sent us four. So now we got 16 guys on the team. And with me being the 15th, I got pushed down to 16. They said, well, look, Charlie, we got to let you go. We're sorry. And I didn't just move to Dallas and everything. I'm like, man. So got to go home again. Hey, babe, yeah, we got to do something else. This didn't work. So next thing you know, I went back home. I was back in Flint, you know, working out. I was there for about a month, you know, just trying to figure something out. You know, I was living with my parents, you know, which was tough, you know. Me and my wife, you know, we had to kick my little brother out of his bedroom. He was sleeping on the couch for a little while. But, you know, he accommodated me, you know, so I appreciate him for that. Then I got a call to go to Italy. I was like, no NBA teams were signing me, so I'm like, Italy? I've never been out the country before. You know, I've been to, you know, Puerto Rico and stuff like that, you know, playing in basketball tournaments in college, but Italy? I'm like, man, I don't know, but when they told me what the contract was and nobody else was paying me, so I said, you know what, I'm going to Italy. So I get there, and our coach at the time was Mike D'Antoni. He's an NBA coach now, but he was coaching in Italy before. And, you know, it was a great situation. It was a small city, and we were, like, going into the playoffs. Anybody heard of Ginobili, Manu Ginobili? You know, I played against him over there. And at the time, you know, he was probably one of the better players over there, but, you know, me being a defensive guy, that was one of the main reasons why the team signed me, because they wanted me to be the Ginobili stopper. And I stopped him. Yeah, he only had like 20. He only had like 20, but and we ended up winning the championship. The Italian League Championship. It was probably it was definitely different, you know, being in Italy. You know, like I said, I never lived out the country. And one thing for me, you know, I don't speak Italian. And where I was at, a lot of those people, they didn't speak English. So, you know, I'm in a city. I used to go to the grocery store and don't nobody. I can't talk to nobody. And I think a lot of stuff that I was used to here is different there. Like there, like when one thing I remember is, you know, when you go get fruit, you know, you put it in the bag, you take it to the register, they weigh it and they do it. They over in Italy, you got to do it yourself. And I didn't know it, so I get the fruit, I go to the register, I'm like, and they're like, no. I'm like, man, what are you talking about, lady? What is this fruit weigh? So somebody had to come take me back to the fruit section, put it on the scale, but do the thing myself, put the little sticker on. I'm like, oh, okay, I had to do it myself. Okay, why you ain't say so? But it was, you know, very different, you know? So, but like I said, I think we beat Ginobili's team in the semifinals, and then we played in the finals. We played another team that was really good, and they had home court advantage. It was the best of five series. We went there. We won the first game. We went back to our place. We won the second, and which was the craziest thing in the world. We won the third game. We were winning the third game at their place, and with a minute left, their fans, like, came on the court. And they canceled the game. They forfeited the game, and we just took off the court because their fans didn't want us to win the championship on their court. They didn't want us to officially win it on their court. So the fans came on. So it was some stuff you'll never see here in America. I was like, man, what is going on? Like, wow. So then, but then too, we was playing the EuroLeague Championship Final Four because it's two different things. You got EuroLeague and you got the Italian League. We won the Italian League, and then we were playing against a team from Europe. I can't remember where, but, you know, they have trash cans, and they set fire to the trash cans in the arena. I'm like, man, what is going on around here? But it's like, you know, how they're passionate about their sports in those different countries. Like, as far as, I mean, you see the soccer games on TV. It's just like that, but on a smaller scale in the basketball arena. So it was definitely, you know, a different experience for me, you know, being over in Italy. But after that season, after winning the championship, after being in the NBA the year before, I'm like, okay, some NBA team is going to sign me next year. Next thing you know, like, summer, I played in the summer league, you know, nothing happened. Nobody wanted to sign me. So I'm like, okay, man, you know, what am I going to do? So actually, the team that Ginobili played for, you know, since he was coming to the NBA and I played well against him, that team signed me that next year. So I'm like, all right. So I go there. It was in Bologna, Italy. So I'm there, and this is probably like the moment of my career that kind of even changed me even more. Like, I always worked hard, but that season, I ended up tearing my MCL. You know, so I was playing. Next thing you know, this guy fell on my leg, and the MCL is right there on the inside, and I felt it like snap. I'm like, oh, whew, that don't feel good. So after the game, you know, like I said, I'm in another country, and the doctor comes in, and, you know, he's playing. He was like, nah, you need surgery. I'm like, surgery? Nah, I don't know about that. So next thing you know, I'm at the hospital, and they're like, you know, and I'm trying to talk to somebody, and the thing is, nobody spoke English. I'm in another country. They're about to do surgery on me, and I don't know what they're doing. I don't know what's going on. I'm trying to talk to somebody. I'm like, hey, can I talk to the doctor? I'm very nervous. I'm scared. You know, they got the little IV in my arm. They like, calm down, calm. I'm like, no, I need to talk to somebody. I want to know. Somebody got to ease my fears right now because I'm scared. And next thing you know, I saw the lady come too. She came and she did something to the little IV. And next thing you know, I was waking up in the recovery room. They tricked me, man. They put me to sleep before somebody could talk to me, man. I'm like, man, why y'all do me like that? So I woke up and I'm like, looked down, my leg, it was, you know, all braced up. I'm like, man. So, you know, I went home after that. Well, I didn't go home. They wouldn't let me come back to the United States. I had to stay in Italy, you know, and do my rehab, which was even harder because if anybody ever been injured, you know, you do rehab, you know, they kind of try to get the motion back. Because, like, this leg was strong. This one was like a little puny leg because it's, when you don't do nothing for a month, you know, you use all your muscle and everything was gone. So I had to try to get all that back, which was extremely hard. And I lost like the range of motion. So I had to lay like on my stomach and somebody would bend my leg to try to get like the motion back. And it was painful. And the guy who did it, he didn't speak English either. So it was like, yo, what are you doing? I'm cussing him out. He didn't even know it. He probably was cussing me out, like, man, stop being a punk, man. Just man up. You'll be all right. I didn't know. I was scared. So, but during that time, it was like, you know, I thought my career was over. You know, that was my first real major injury. You know, I sprained my ankle before and did things like that. But, you know, when you go and do surgery, it's like I thought that, you know, it was over. My career is over. Like, I would never be the same player I was. And after like 2-3 months, I was back playing, but at the same time, I didn't feel the same. I felt like, man, you know, this is like the worst thing ever. Like, you know, what am I gonna do? I'm only like 22, 23 years old. Am I done playing? I don't know, because I can't play the same way I was playing. But after time and more rehab, you know, everything got better. And one thing I took from that is like, you know, never take anything for granted. You know, anything can happen at any given time. So I started to work out even harder. Like, you know what? I enjoy this sport. You know what? Let me put my all into it because at any given moment, it can be over. So why not go out there and be the best that you can be and not just try to fit in. But so the next year, you know, definitely no NBA team call because I wasn't 100%. But by the time the season came around next year, I went back to Italy again. And I was probably one of my best seasons ever. After, like I said, after I was injured and I just was working out harder than ever, I ended up leading, you know, the whole country of Italy in scoring. I averaged like 25 points a game. And it's like, whoa, who's this guy? So next thing you know, I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to go to the NBA now. I'm ready. Next thing you know, nope, didn't happen. Nobody from there said, nah, you're not good enough. So I'm like, man, what I got to do? So next thing you know, I go to Spain the next year. I get a contract in Spain. And then the league in Spain was a little better than the one in Italy. I mean, they're both really good leagues, but the ACB is what it's called in Spain. It's really, you know, a good league. So I go there, and I started off the season really not good at all. It was really bad. Like, it was just like I felt like people were like, there was a lot of pressure, you know, especially leading Italy in scoring, averaging 25 a game. It's like, okay, this guy's a big-time scorer. He's going to score a lot of points for us. And I got there, I just wasn't clicking right away. I don't know what it was. That's like a lot of those clips y'all saw. I was in Spain, but that was later in the season when I kind of got my confidence going. And but the thing that y'all going to think is funny, man, but like I felt like I was sluggish. I'm like, man, I need something. And I never drank coffee before. So somebody, you know, some of the, like the, you know, Spanish guys, you know, before the game, they sitting there with the little espressos and stuff. I'm like, man, let me try one of those. So I got my little espresso. I'm like, that's nasty. I had the best game of my life. I was out there balling. I was energy, So every game, I was drinking the espresso. go out, score 30. Next game, give me that espresso. 35, oh, give me that espresso. 40, I'm like, hey, I was feeling good out there. So I had like 10 straight games where I was averaging over like 30 points a game, and it was crazy. I go to cities and, you know, teams, and like little kids was coming up to me. Oh, Charlie Bell, come here next year. I'm like, I don't know where I'm gonna be next year. You know, if they pay me, I'll be here, I don't know. But it was, a great time in my career. And, that year, after that season, I think my agent at the time, I ended up changing agents, but my agent had a mini camp in Chicago for all his clients, everybody that he represented. He had like a little mini camp. So I went to his mini camp and I played well. And then next thing you know, the New York Knicks, the Portland Trail Blazers, and the Milwaukee Bucks all invited me to their little mini camps. So I'm like, all right. So I go to the mini camps, all of them go well. Then Milwaukee was the last one. And so I go the first day, y'all heard a little bit in the tape that they showed, but the first day I played well, but I was going up for a rebound and I kind of fell on my back and I'm like, man, I was kind of a little hurt, so I couldn't really play no more. And they was like, well, look, Charlie, we don't need you to play no more. We watched you in Italy, we watched you in Spain, we watched you, we've had our eye on you. We've been, we got scouts everywhere, we've been keeping up with you, and you know what? We like you, we're gonna sign you, so you don't have to do anything else, as far as that mini camp. It was just like, and one thing we like about you, I remember, I always tell that story, they say, you know what, Charlie, one thing about it is that every year you've gotten better. And that's something that I learned, I think, hard work from my parents, but also Coach Izzo. Like, after that, my freshman year, it was like, you can't rest on what you did. You got to get better because, y'all see every year there's, 45 to 60 guys who get drafted into the NBA. That's a new 45 guys, new 60 guys coming into the NBA. So that means that there's 45, 60 guys out the NBA. I think the average career for an NBA guy is only like 3-4 years. So that's the average. So guys are in there for 3 years, 4 years, and they're not in the NBA no more. So it's like one of those things that you have to constantly get better. You constantly got to stay on top of your game because there's somebody trying to take your spot. So that was, like I said, one thing I always knew was just get better, get better, get better. And so that's what they liked about me. It's like, you continue to get better year in and year out. I'm like, well, thank you. And so I signed a contract. At first it was gonna be a 1 year, but then my agent got it up to 2 years. So I had a 2-year guaranteed contract. I'm like, which I didn't have my first year. I only had like they call it unguaranteed. So they can cut you at any time. So that's why I kept getting cut. But anyway, I finally got a 2-year guaranteed contract. So I get to practice with Milwaukee. And the first thing they say is with the coach, he says, Charlie, look, I know you led Spain in scoring. I know you led Italy in scoring. I know you did a lot of scoring, but here we want you to be a good practice player. You're probably not gonna play much. We just want you, work hard. Be a good guy. I'm like, all right, cool. I listened to that, but at the same time, I knew that I can play in the NBA. So I was a good practice player. I was there every working hard. But after practice was over, I would work out. I would like five. So we only like in the NBA, you only practice maybe once a day. So you practice at like 10, 11 o'clock, and you're probably done by 12:30. You practice, lift weights, go home, and then you got the whole day. So I would always call up the assistant coach and say, well, coach, one of the assistant coaches, hey, coach, can you meet me at the gym at 8 o'clock tonight? All right, I'll be there. So I would take my wife to the gym. Like, hey, I need you to rebound for me. I need to work on this jump shot. I need to work on this, because I wanted to get better. So next thing half the season went by and all our guards, we had Michael Redd, Mo Williams, who was with Cleveland this year, won the championship, and very happy for him. He's a great guy. TJ Ford was another guy. Those are all like our guards, like our guys who played a lot of minutes. And next thing they all got hurt. And then coach was like, well, look, Charlie, we need you to play now. I said, all right, coach, I got it. So, because I've been working out. I've been ready. So next thing I get out there and I play, I had a very good game. The next game, I had a good game. Couple games in, I'm scoring like 20 points a game. Next thing we were playing against the Phoenix Suns, Steve Nash and those guys, and I go out and get a triple-double. And now it's like, you know, who is this guy? Like, sitting on the end of the bench, and now y'all here getting triple-doubles. Who is this guy? So next thing you know, I started to play a lot more, you know, scoring 20, 25 a game. Next thing you know, that summer, I continued to get better because I knew I was going to play this next year because I done went out there and, you know, kind of proved myself. And the next year, the same thing happened. All them guys get hurt again. So the whole season, you know, I'm playing like 35, 40 minutes a game. You know, I play well, and, you know, because I was ready, you know, because all the work and the effort and the time I put into it, you know, I stayed ready, and I did what I had to do, and when that time was right, because when my number was called, you know, I stepped up and did what I had to do and played well, and next thing you know, ended up signing a contract with the Miami Heat. That after those 2 years, but that was a restricted free agent, which means that if you're restricted, you know, the team that you're playing on can match any offer. So I went out, I got an offer from Miami. I thought I was going to Miami. I'm like, I'm about to go down here, D-Wade, Shaq, Charlie. That's gonna be the big three right there. No, really not a big three, but it was like, you know, I would have been like number five or six, but still, I'm gonna say big three. But you know, Milwaukee ended up matching it. And I went back to Milwaukee, and I played there, you know, for another 4 years. And then I got traded out to Golden State. And I actually played with, like, Steph Curry. I think it was his second season I was out there. It was like Monte Ellis, Steph Curry, Darrell Wright. We had, you know, David Lee was on the team. We had a pretty good team, but we still didn't make the playoffs. But those guys were... You know, we had a lot of fun, and I'm just like, you know, watching them play now, man. You know, Steph is a great guy. You know, my son's birthday this past year, you know, Steph left me tickets, you know, brought us in on the locker room after the game, signed some shoes for him. My son was happy as can be. It's funny because my son, he's 12 now. He really loves basketball, but when he was little, I used to try to take him to the gym. He never wanted to go. I'm like, son, let's go to the gym. No, I'm going to play these video games, Dad. Why? Bye. I'm not gonna make you go to the gym. So now he loves basketball. It's funny because like a couple months ago, he sent me a YouTube video of myself. Like, I ain't know you can do that, Dad. My son, golly, I didn't know you could dunk. Yeah, I could dunk, man. What's wrong with you, man? I had hops. Could jump out the gym. Like, I couldn't jump out the gym, but you know, I could dunk. But my son, he never really, I guess, you know, now he knows, but I ended up having to, like, you know, the 2K17 about to come out. I had to get on eBay and I found like 2K11. That was back when I was good. Like, I got that on Xbox and sent it to him, like, here you go, play with me, man. You know, yeah, you do that crossover with your dad, you know. But so it was kind of cool. But like I said, just hard work, man. You know, just what's got me where I, you know, got me to, you know, help me accomplish everything that I wanted. It was just, you know, working hard, man. Like I said, with that injury, you know, not taking things for granted, you know, just working hard. And, you know, and things, you know, it paid off for me, you know, and, you know, even to this day, you know, everywhere I go, especially at Michigan State, you know, everybody, like, last year I got inducted to the Michigan State Hall of Fame. This upcoming December, I'm going into the Flint Hall of Fame. So these are things that I never thought that would happen. You know, like, especially growing up, man, you know, it's like, you know, I used to look up to guys and now I'm going into the Hall of Fame, you know, and being mentioned with these same guys is like, you know, the best thing in the world. And, you know, like I say, playing in the NBA, was probably like the highlight of my life, my career, you know, playing against the best players in the world. You know, I'm gonna open up the questions in a minute, but just to take one question away, everybody always asks me, who was harder to guard, Kobe or LeBron? I'm gonna say Kobe. Yeah, I just think that, you know, it was hard guarding Kobe, man. See, LeBron liked to pass the ball, he gonna do other stuff. Kobe trying to score. Like, one of my college teammates played for the Toronto Raptors when Kobe had, like, 81 or 82 on him. So every time I talk to him, like, man, y'all couldn't stop him, huh, at all? Like, you couldn't do nothing? Like, foul him? like hug them, something. Y'all let them score 80 some points. How you let somebody score 80 on you? But that was definitely, you know, something that I looked forward to every game, though, is, you know, having to guard the other team's best player. And those guys, you know, then they see me, they still be like, man, you know, glad you ain't in the league no more. I don't want you guarding me. I'm like, yeah, I know you don't. But it was a lot of fun, man. But I don't know if anybody, I'm gonna open up with questions. I don't know if anybody got any questions about anything. Right there. Am I a big NBA fan? Oh. What other players made it big? And oh, from my final, on my team. Okay, no. Throughout my college career, I think Mateen Cleaves, he played in the, you know, he's a point guard. He got drafted. Morris Peterson. We were all from Flint, so when we was in college, he used to call us the Flintstones. We had T-shirts, little cartoon, you know, like drawings on our, like everybody in Flint had a Flintstone T-shirt. It was like four of us, always all from the same city. After that, I think Jason Richardson, who, you know, he won like the dunk contest a couple of times. You know, I think he just retired last year. And also Zach Randolph, who's still playing. Zach was a freshman when I was a senior, you know, and I knew when Zach came in, I was like, you know, he only played 1 year at Michigan State, and I knew he was going to the NBA. He was talented. You know, he's a big guy. Not very athletic, but he can score. Like, man, like, who is this guy, man? I thought he was, like, unathletic, uncoordinated. I'm like, man, he's a dude, man. But we couldn't stop him, though. Every day in practice, he was giving us buckets. And he went on. He's still playing in the league. So other than that, I think that's about it for Michigan State, who I played with, that played in the, who played in the NBA. Yep, behind you. To how did I get? How did I get connected with this? Oh, okay. No. I have a friend who he does XM radio. I don't know if you guys listen to NBA radio, but he has a show called The Bottom Line Sports Show, and I go on his show a lot to talk about basketball. You know, he's a friend of mine who knew somebody from here, kind of connected me, and I'm here in New York right now. Like I said, I'm working at the NBA right now. The corporate offices in on Fifth Avenue, like I did player development, like, you know, as far as, you know, the NBA does and they also have an NBA, like a union also, but the NBA player development is, you know, we work with current and former NBA guys as far as what they want to do outside of basketball. So that's what I'm doing, you know. Here in New York, I'll be here for like another month. Well, actually, next week, on Saturday, I'm going to South Africa, to Johannesburg. Then I'm going to Cameroon and Angola with the NBA, because we're doing, it's called Basketball Without Borders, and we do like a clinic and camps and, you know, do the speaking stuff over there. So Saturday, I'm going for 2 weeks. So I'm looking forward to that. So that's just how I got connected, just a friend of a friend, and it was like, hey, we'd like you to speak. I was like, I like to speak, so I'll be here. I'm trying to be working on my comedian skills, too, I guess. I don't know. You don't want to raise it all the way? You're just going to give me the little, hey. What's that? Where would I think I would be if I didn't get into basketball? Growing up, I was big into like drawing. You know, I used to love to draw. You know, I majored in advertising. I'm actually doing stuff with the marketing department at the NBA also, because, you know, I have a passion for that. And but I like during my NBA career, you know, once I started playing, you know, I didn't draw anymore. So I kind of lost those skills. But I do have a daughter. I'm like, man, I think she got those skills from me. I think she got it because she can draw really good. But I think she got that from daddy. But you had one, or? Oh, yeah. Like I say, I probably have an advertising company or something. I'm kind of creative. I like to come up with different crazy stuff. I don't know. Like you, if you go home and you're on YouTube, you have to Google, "Hey Charlie, do my job." That's the thing I did with Milwaukee, because like in the summer, you don't have much to do. You know, you're just working out. So I went to our marketing people, our PR people. I said, "Hey man, I want to do other people's job for a day." And they was like, "Charlie, that's great." I said, "Well, yeah, let's do it." So we ended up doing a contest, and I did 5 different jobs. I worked at Wendy's. I worked at a dairy farm, which is milking cows, which was, you know, very fun. Like, you just don't know how happy I was to milk a cow. But I also worked at Crate and Barrel. I did like a postman, and then I did like another job too. But it's just, "Hey Charlie, do my job." You'll see it on YouTube. It's, you know, it's pretty funny. It's pretty, you know, I try to keep it, you know, my comedy, you know, try to keep people laughing. Right here. The best advice I got from coaches, like I said, I think just hard work, you know, never being satisfied. Like I said, but he, you know, he preaches it, but at the same time, you know, he practices what he preaches. You know, every day, you know, he is at practice. You know, he's watching film. He's doing everything he can. He's working hard. You know, he's not on the court playing like us, but he's doing everything he can to keep us prepared. And like I said, he, after my freshman year, the way he cussed me out, I learned a lot from that 10 minutes of verbal abuse, that I need to work hard. Like, I need to continue to get better. I mean, that's just something that, I respect out of him, is that, you know, he could have let me do whatever, but he cared enough about me, he cared enough about all his guys that, you know, he wants to see you succeed, he wants to see you get better year in and year out. Right there. Oh, you know what, when I played in Spain, you know, Italy, I was, you know, I learned a little bit, but when I played in Spain, the team actually gave me a Spanish teacher for like the whole season. So, but that was like 10 years ago. When I was there, I was, como estas, I was speaking a little bit. Like, I was able to go to the store and be like, you know, say what I needed, you know, or when the coach was talking, you know, before the game, you know, coach is giving the pregame speech and then he's saying it in Spanish. I was able to understand it, you know, but now, you know, I know a little bit. It's so funny, like when you learn, it's like I know the words, but, you know, when somebody's speaking Spanish, they speak so fast. Like, I don't know when one word ends and when the next one begins. I'm like, man, slow down. Write it down. Well, hold on, I got this Google Translate. Yeah, well, over here. Oh, since I played for Golden State, what do I think about Kevin Durant? I think it's a good move for him. I knew he was gonna go. I didn't know it, but I had an idea that I don't think that him and Westbrook got along very well. I think they're just two different personalities. I think they play well together, but at the same time, I don't think they got along. And I think for Kevin Durant, I think he wants to win championships, but at the same time, he wants to enjoy playing basketball. And I think when you look at Golden State, you see how much fun that team has with each other. And I think that he kind of wants to be a part of that. He wants to have fun playing basketball and winning. But I think Westbrook stressed him out a little bit. I think he was like, "Hey, I need to get out of here. I can't play with this guy." Westbrook is a different guy. He plays, you know, very, very aggressive, right? Yeah. But I mean, I like the way he play. I mean, but at the same time, I don't think their personalities were the same. So I'm happy for him. I'm happy for Golden State. I was pulling for him for this year. I'm gonna be pulling for him next year because I want to see, you know, Draymond Green went to Michigan State, so he's a Spartan. So I kind of want to see him do well. And Steph, that's my man. How long did I play for? I played in the NBA 8 years, and then I played 4 years in Europe, so 12 years. So I played, you know, quite a bit, you know, a time in the league. You know, I think I wish I would have played more. But, you know, I always like to talk about, you know, making it to the league. But, you know, I did some stuff to get me out and get, like, to get myself out of the league. I made a mistake, you know, as far as drinking and driving. I got a DUI, and if y'all Google, y'all can see that too. But, you know, like I said, I made a mistake, and, you know, some that I, you know, I got to live and I learned from. And you just got to make sure it don't happen. You just got to, you know, continue to work hard. You know, I worked hard on the court. Now I'm working hard off the court to, you know, become a successful, you know, businessman, you know, coaching, you know, general manager of a team. You know, I'm working hard to get, you know, where I want to get after basketball also. Right there, the blue shirt. What I've learned so far? Three quotes? Wow, I don't know. Yeah, I do. I don't know if we got time to take some photos, but no, I think one thing for me, you know, just, you know, hard work, dedication, getting better, just continue to get better, improve. One thing my dad always told me, like growing up, my dad used to always say kind of stuff to me, but, you know, he never, like I would score like 50 points in a game. And I come home and be like, yeah. My dad would be like, ah, but you missed two free throws. I'd be like, man, I have 50 though. Ah, but you missed them two free throws. Like, it was never, you know, good enough. It was like always, you know, like I said, he always wanted me to get better and just always get better. And one thing about, you know, like I was playing in Italy and Spain, I was playing all these different places and in high school. You know, as far as college or, you know, I didn't go to a very popular basketball high school, but my dad was like, you know, if you're good enough, they'll find you. And they found, Michigan State found me. And another thing he kind of always told me is like, you know, the same people that you pass on the way up is the same people you're going to pass on the way down. So everybody always treat everybody the same. You know, and I think when I meet people, they don't even know I played basketball because there's a lot of athletes who kind of have like this, you know, big head, like, oh, I'm such and such. You know, for me, it's like most people don't even know I play basketball because I'm so silly. Like, if you hang around me, then all I do is crack jokes all day. Like, I don't even get mad at my kids when they do something. It's like, you crazy. Like, that's funny. So it's like, I don't know. I just find humor in everything. I don't know why. I just always laughing. Like, I'd be laughing. Y'all got Snapchat, like that one filter where your face look big, like, I was at work last week just crying, laughing at my desk by myself, like with the filter. I was just, this is crazy. But that's just me, man. You know, I don't know. But a lot of people don't, I just try to stay humble, you know, just always kind of, you know, just treat everybody the way you want to be treated is what I would say. We got one, that's it. We got to stop. So thank y'all. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.